Happy Easter. Come on, let's stand to our feet. Let's worship the Lord together this morning. Amen.
Up that name. Welcome to Harvest. My name is John, and I'm so glad you're here for Easter Sunday. And if we haven't had a chance to meet, I got to meet a lot of you before church, but if this is your first time or you haven't been here in a while, we'd love to just have a conversation with you briefly in the lobby, and there's going to be some treats after the service as well. So hang out, spend some time together with the family of the Lord. Today is a great day. And for the rest of us, I would encourage you to get out your phones at some point to scan a QR code or just to go onto the app. Let us know that you're here, but more than that, you can follow along in the message today on the app. And during the week, you can let us know if there's a way that we can be praying for you. We want to care for you. To have more and better disciples and more and better leaders, well, there has to be a care. There has to be an interaction. So let's do that with each other this week. You know, we're not the only church in town today that's celebrating that Jesus is alive. And so would you join me in praying for Pastor Mo Zachariah? He's at City Line Church, and they're in Niles. And so why don't we just pray for them right now as we start our service? God, you are so good, and we are celebrating today that you are alive. You conquered death, and we celebrate that. We celebrate that you are the one and only. You are the true God. And Lord, we are so thankful. And as that gospel message goes forth in the city of Niles today through Pastor Mo at City Line, I pray that you would just have your hand of protection on him as he opens your word, that the Spirit of the living God would be able to move alive and free in their midst. And Father, would you do that very same thing here today as the gospel is being proclaimed? Would you help our hearts to be tender in a place of reception for the good word? We love you and ask for you to do a great work. Amen. Well, I'd like to direct your attention to the screen.
Today is Resurrection Day. Today, there is a lot to celebrate. There is a message to be received that has been passed on. Will you have ears to hear it?
According to the scriptures, like sheep, we have all gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way.
According to the scriptures, God loved the world. He loves you so much that he gave his one and only son.
He was nailed to the cross by lawless people, died, and was buried. End of story.
Another failed Messiah.
Until
the women came to the tomb on the morning of the third day. The angel told the women, "Don't be afraid, because I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay."
They noticed that the stone in front of the tomb, which was very large, has been rolled away.
"Don't be alarmed," the angel told them. "You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here."
God raised him up, ending the pains of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by death.
"Why are you looking for the living among the dead?
He is not here. He has risen."
This is the message that we declare today, the news that we celebrate.
What was passed on, that we also receive. So today, rejoice, because Christ has risen.
Christ is risen.
Jesus te jingle.
Cristo ha resucitado.
Cristo uertirikino.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Empty slate at the empty are singing and dancing and laughing. The Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming. Roses in bloom, pushed out from the embers. Rivers of tears flow from good times remembering. And families are singing and dancing and laughing. The Father is welcoming.
We lift our song today. They came to mourn. are risen with him. 1 Peter 1:3 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. He is risen today. And we get to celebrate together. He's pulled each and every one of us from the pit, from the mire, from death, and he's moved us to life. It's a gift. It's a gift of his son, the gift of his kingdom, and we get to revel in it today. And part of that revelry is our giving. For what Christ has given, we give in return. So today we have four ways to give on the screen. And as you consider your offering, consider the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus, and consider his return. For he will come back. He will come back for his children, for his church, and we will be ready. So let's lift this offering to the Lord. Jesus, we are grateful. We thank you, God, that you gave your one and only Son, that you gave the Spirit to live inside of us, and Lord, that you've given us this day to remember forever as the day you conquered everything in your path, everything in the path of ours that would just lead to you, God. We thank you that you have made a way. And Lord, we offer these gifts to you. We say, Lord, they're yours. This day, we celebrate, God. We thank you for all that you've done and for all that you are. And God, as we continue singing, as we continue worshiping, let your praise be lifted high. We pray this in your holy and precious name. Amen. Amen. Let's keep singing, church.
To fulfill the law and prophets.
Wow, we get the chance to lift high the name of Jesus today, Resurrection Day, Easter. He is alive. He is risen. So before you have a seat, share that excitement with the person next to you. Tell them, Happy Resurrection Day. He is risen. Well, I'd like to encourage you to find your Bibles, and if you want to open them up to 1 Corinthians 15, if you don't have one, these verses are going to be on the screen. Would encourage you to follow along this morning. Paul wrote these words to us today. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that as he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time. Most of them are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, and then he appeared to the apostles. Last of all, he appeared to the untimely born. He appeared also to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it is not I, but the grace of God that is within me. So whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. Dear Father, thanks for this passage. Thanks for this truth that you conquered death, that you are alive. And as we take some time in your word today, would you just soften our hearts to receive it and then be a people who are about to share it? It's in Jesus' great name that we pray. Amen.
I was just walking out behind the sheer screen there. The church I used to serve, we used to have this big tomb on the stage that had the stone rolled away and like steam coming out of it. And I used to always make jokes that every year I was going to actually come out of the tomb. But I decided that probably wasn't the most appropriate thing, right? One day I will. It's great to see you. If you are new here, I want to introduce myself. My name is Jeff Bucknam. I have the privilege of being the lead teaching pastor here, and we want to study God's Word together. The passage that was just written, was written by the Apostle Paul, and I want to study that particular text, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 to 11. I'm going to do some stuff on this screen over here, so if you can bring a Bible with you, you can follow along with me as I read through the passage and circle some things I want you to notice about it, but it's always good to bring your Bible along, keep notes and those sorts of things, and make sure that I'm not telling you fibs about what it says. I want to show you a picture. This is a picture of Mount Baker, where I used to live in British Columbia, Canada, is right there. My house is right about there. This is the view that I would see every day. If you've been to British Columbia, you know it rains a lot. So when I say every day, I mean like 4 days of the year, you'd see this view. Everywhere around town, you'd see Mount Baker. It's about 11,000 feet high, and it ascends from the valley floor straight up. Used to tell the Canadians there that the Mount Baker's in the United States. It's in Washington State, but the best views of it are from Canada. But I used to always tell the Canadians that, you know, the best views in your country are of the U.S. But it's a magnificent mountain. You'd be driving around town. There are moments that you noticed it. And it would just be ascending above these hills, and different angles of it gave you a different appreciation for it. But you know, I lived there for 15 years, and you know, it becomes familiar. You can drive around all the time. It can be a gloriously sunny day, and you see this mountain, and you don't really pay it much notice. The majesty is kind of always there. But then someone would come to visit, or somebody from who moved into the town. You know, you'd go for a walk with them, or you'd show them around, and one of the things that you would they'd immediately say to you is, "Oh my word. We need to stop right here. There are roads in the middle of my town of Abbotsford, British Columbia, where the road drives directly at the mountain, and it ascends above the hills and the high evergreen trees frame this mountain." Or like this picture, you have a river that you're looking down, and there's this massive mountain. And I've actually been in the car before with people who say, "Can we stop for a minute?" You know, because they're trying to get the picture out the front. And they go, "You can pull over. Why? What is wrong? We gotta stop. Look at that mountain." And as somebody who's lived there all these years, I was like, "Yeah, it's a mountain. Yeah, but what a mountain." Chicago's an amazing city. You go downtown, you see the skyline, you see the lake. It's fantastic. You've lived here for a long, long time, many of you. Visitors come in, they go into Chicago, and they stand at the foot of the Hancock Tower or the Sears/Willis Tower, whatever, and they look up at it, and they're like, "Holy smokes, look at that thing." And you're like, "What?" "Look, it's huge, this building." "Oh, yeah, yeah, it's big." Familiarity, yeah, they say familiarity breeds contempt. I don't know if that's necessarily the case so much as familiarity breeds indifference. Get used to it, these majestic, amazing things. It's one of the hard parts about being a Christian, quite honestly, for lots and lots of years, is that if you've been in the church a long time and your church has been faithful, you've heard the gospel message repeatedly, you know, the news that Jesus died for our sins. And then on the third day, he rose again. You've heard it so many times. Preachers try to use different illustrations to try to get you to connect with it. After a while, you know, it just sort of washes over you. You're like, "Oh, yeah, yeah, uh-huh, that's true, uh-huh." The preacher starts dancing around and throwing their arms around and saying, "But look at how magnificent it is." And we're like, yeah, when do the bears start? It's not that we don't think it's majestic if you're a Christian. It is majestic. It's just always there. What we need, honestly, what we need is somebody to come along, get their camera phone out, and start taking the pictures and saying, pull over, we want to get out of the car so we can stop and have a look. And when you stand there together and we gaze at this majestic peak of the gospel of Jesus Christ, we all of a sudden start remembering of how great it is. So look, on this Easter morning, what I want to do is I want to pull a car over with you. And I want to have a look at the gospel. And I want you to see how fantastic it is. This is really what Paul is doing in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. He's going to try to challenge this congregation of people, the Corinthians, who at this point actually believed that the resurrection of Jesus Christ had already happened, some of them. And this is a major problem for them. And he gets into this whole argument in 1 Corinthians 15 and the rest of the chapter, which we're going to get into in the coming weeks, right? But here he says, look, before we get into any discussion about all of that, can we just review the gospel? Let's just start with the gospel. And in this passage, I want to show you four facts about the good news of Jesus Christ. Four facts that maybe you already know, but I just want to have a look at them. I want to point out the different angles of that mountain for a second. Have a look at this particular ravine that stretches up the side of it. So here's the first of them. The gospel is something to be reminded of. Yes, it's a message that many, many people believe in who are the Christian church. Lots of people who come here on an Easter Sunday. Yep, absolutely believe it. They might be really committed to it or not, but it is something that we're actually supposed to be repeatedly reminded of. You get that from the very beginning of this passage that we read just a few minutes ago. Paul writes, now I would remind you, there's the word, brothers, of the gospel that I preach to you, which you receive and in which you stand. I want you to think about the gospel. So let's think about the gospel. I think there are five basically true beliefs that Americans have, no matter what American you are. I think there are some outliers, right? Some people who say, no, I don't believe that at all. But I think there are five commonly held true beliefs that Americans have, okay? So here's the five. Number one, I think that most Americans believe that there is a moral standard in the world. Now, we argue about what that moral standard is, yes? In fact, most of our politics is around what the moral standard is. Some people say, well, morally, you should do this with your sexuality. And other people say, morally, you should do that with your sexuality. But the question of morality, whether or not there is a moral standard, that's settled for everyone. Everyone believes in a moral standard. There are things that are right and there are things that are wrong. Everyone holds that viewpoint. Everyone sits inside their house at some point and reads Twitter or watches the news and looks to their friend and spouse, whatever, and says, that should not be. Here's the way it should be. Everybody has a moral standard. Second, I think we all believe that those who keep the moral standards are good and those who don't are bad. In fact, that's what makes you good or bad, is whether or not you meet up to whatever moral standard it is. He's a really good guy. By that, you mean, oh, that person is kind and nice, and they meet up to the things that we hold highly in our society. He's a jerk. What do you mean? Well, he's rude, and he's arrogant, and those are all bad things. They're against the moral standard. So there's a moral standard. Those who keep the moral standards are good, and those who don't are bad. Third, good people get God's favor and blessing, and bad people deserve judgment. Good people deserve our affirmation, and they deserve to be in the newspaper. They deserve to go on have the highlight reel done of them. They might play a particular sport and everything's fantastic in how they play, but we really love it when they're a really kind person as well, right? Look at this person. He's nice to people who have disabilities. Those kinds of people, those good people, deserve affirmation and blessing, but those who don't do those things, we want them to lose. We think that they are going to see God one day and they're going to get it, right? Especially the people we are really against us, who we really think are bad. You know, the Trump or the Biden or you pick. I don't care. Whoever your person is, well, Hitler's going to get it. Yeah, okay. So is George Bush. I've heard it all. There's a moral standard. Those who keep the moral standards are good. Those who don't are bad. Good people gets God's favor and blessing, and bad people deserve judgment. You can see that, quite honestly, these days with the whole cancel culture thing. Most of the people get really frustrated with cancel culture, but what's behind it is really interesting. It's this understanding that, look, we instinctively know that the people who do things that are outside the bounds of our morality should be somehow cast outside the city, outside the walls. We should show them that they're not doing things right. Fourth, though, and this is the one that I think some people don't openly admit, but I think deep down inside we all agree. Fourth, we all fail those moral standards. All of us do. Look, you might say, well, I'm pretty good. Okay, but okay, let's be honest though, okay? So you got your little phone, everybody got your phone on. Let's put the recorder on. I actually want to make an app. And here's the app. I want it to actually record every time you use the word should. Right? So you're driving down the road. That guy shouldn't be such a jerk driving. Records it. This person should act that way. That person should give more. This person shouldn't post that on Instagram. Just all the shoulds. And this app tracks you, right? Like all the apps track you. And when you do something that is against one of the shoulds that it's recorded, it should beep and shake. Right? So it's recording your whole moral framework, what you think is good, bad. And when you do something bad that is against the moral framework that you yourself have established, it would go beep. Dude, we'd be beeping and zzz all day. You know that, right? Everything you did, you wouldn't get through a single trip in your car without that thing beeping and zzz. That person shouldn't speed. Then you go fast, beep, zzz. We all fail our moral standards, which means, quietly, we're all hypocrites, all of us. And fifth, I think that because we say that good people deserve the blessing and bad people deserve the judgment, and we have shown ourselves to be bad by our own standards, we would then end up saying that we deserve judgment, right? In fact, it's just for us to deserve judgment. No, wait a minute. Basically, here's the way it works. I believe that people are both good and bad, and if you do more good than bad, then you will be considered a good person. Okay, let's try this out in a court of law. You go in there and you're on trial for, I don't care, murder, rape, sexual immorality, whatever it is, the thing that you have destroyed people's, whatever, you've done it, and your lawyer stands up and says, "Judge, here's the thing. My client is very, very guilty, right? Clearly guilty of the thing that they're doing. They've ruined lives. They've destroyed people, right? They've held slaves. They've done all of these things, but you need to know that most of the time they're really nice people. Like, seriously, like 70% of the time they don't beat their slave, right? It's 70% of the time they're not racist. 70% of the time they aren't beating their wife. 70% of the time they're not degrading other people with their language. 70% of the time, it's pretty good. Like, it's a C, it's passing. What do you think the judge is going to say? What do you think the people who have been injured are going to say? Oh yeah, totally, that's great, yeah, totally. Ruined my life, but he's got a 70% good rating. Is that just? If the judge said, no, don't worry about it. You got 70%. It's not a big deal. You're more good than bad. So we're going to wipe this whole thing away. Is that just? No. No. So here's the problem. Here's the problem with all of us. How can those who deserve judgment as moral failure, not at every point moral failure, but at, 20%, 30%, whatever. How can those who deserve judgment as moral failures receive blessing from God as moral successes? How do you go from condemnation to commendation? Well, like, how are you going to do that? Well, you can perform better. See how that goes, though. A lot of us are trying real hard to perform. And again, you can move from 70% to maybe 80 or 85%. That's great, but you're only 15% a racist. Good. Still deserve judgment though, right? How do moral failures who deserve judgment receive blessing from God as moral successes? And listen, This is the majesty of the good news. That's the bad news. Here's the majesty of the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. That Jesus says, listen, here's the deal. I will take on your wickedness and the deserved punishment for it, and I will grant you my righteousness in a great exchange. I will take on the judgment that is due you, right? The righteous judge who says you're wicked in these ways and therefore deserves this kind of condemnation. This is from Isaiah 53. He is referring to Jesus was pierced for our transgressions. Who was pierced? He was. For whose transgression? Ours. He was crushed for our iniquities. It was upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed. Look, all we like sheep have gone astray. We've all turned everyone to his own way. But the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was canceled, in other words. The cancellation that you and I deserve, the casting out of the society, the judgment he receives, we receive what? His righteousness, 2 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake, again, for our sake, he made him, Jesus, to be sin who knew no sin. Why? So that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So that in him we might become the righteous. Listen very closely to me. That is not saying in this great exchange that Jesus then restores you. Okay, so he takes on your punishment and all these things. And then he restores you back to like an even keel and gives you a second chance. That's not what the gospel says. The gospel is not saying, hey, it's going to treat you just as if you had never sinned. No, no, no. The gospel says that you get righteousness. You're not just on an even playing field. You're as righteous as Jesus. And remember what we said. Good people deserve blessing and bad people deserve judgment. You were supposed to get judgment. Jesus gets the judgment. You now are good in Christ. So what do you get? What do you get? Blessing. This is so crazy. Listen to me. This is so crazy that if you stood before God and you believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ, right? You did nothing to get this. And Jesus says, you just have faith in me and I'll take your judgment and you can have my righteousness. You can stand before God as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ and say to God, the Almighty, you owe me. I'm in Christ. Therefore, all the blessings, all the merit, all the good that Jesus has done is attributed to me. Not because I did it, but because I'm hidden in him. Right? Here he is. I'm back here. And God, the just God, would only be just if he agreed with you. He said, no, 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 that's, he's breaking his own rules. Woo! How is it that someone like me or like you, who's been recorded as being should, and a hypocrite at every turn, can stand before the Almighty God and say, you owe me because of Christ? It's a scandal. It's craziness. But it's good news. I had a good friend that when I was in college, we made a video. Well, he made a video, right? You know, in your college, this was back in the 90s. And so, you remember the videotapes? Some of you in the room were like, what? the videotapes that you could rewind. Anyway, we did a movie. The movie was Academy Award level stuff. Here's the plot. It was basically it was a basketball movie, and there were a group of bullies who bullied this one guy, but the one guy rose up and he got them back by dunking on their head. So the bullies dunked on his head, and then later on he dunks on their head. Right? Thank you for the award. Anyway, it took a long time to make. Did a lot of editing. My roommate did a ton of editing on this thing. Anyway, there was one section in it, he said, Jeff, I want you to play the bully, which was like, yeah, I can do that. So I want you to play the bully, and I was like, yeah, okay, well, I'll do the bully. And there's this one section, he said, the key scene in the movie, right? We get out there on the court, and we're on these little dunk hoops because none of us can dunk, and so they're like 8 feet. And so I had this one scene where I was supposed to go and just knock out of the way the guy who is being bullied. My friend Jason was playing his role. And he would hit him and then rise up and just dunk right on his head. And then there was a scene where I was supposed to be hanging on the rim and the shot was going to be up like this at me. And I'd go, come down, drop onto the ground and rip my shirt off. Right? Like, so I said to my friend Colin at the time, Colin, you've seen me with my shirt off. I think this is probably not going to have the effect you think. Because you're looking for somebody who's got like a six pack, and I have a one pack. He said, I know. But here's the thing. I got an idea for this. There's a guy on our floor in college. His name was Mark, and Mark loved him some gym time, right? He had black hair, big guy. We were kind of the same size. It's just that my bigness was due to, you know, pancakes, and his bigness was due to the gym. And so he said, we're going to dress you in the same stuff. And so what we'll get you, Jeff, is you'll go and you'll hang on the rim there, right? And we'll get a shot of you like that. But then when this scene drops down, I'll cut away from the head. Mark will rip his shirt off, right? And that'll be that. Okay, so Mark's huge, bulging muscles. And so we do this scene. Fast forward several weeks, and I'm sitting there at the premiere, right? It's in a dorm room, right? But premiere of On the Court. And I'm sitting there on this bed next to two young women who I thought were delightful. And they were sitting there with me and a couple others, but the girls were right next to me. And so we're watching this scene, and the scene comes along. And I go up, knock Jason out of the way. Boom, right? Hanging on the rim, and then they cut away, and down comes someone dressed just like me, looked like me, but they didn't show the head. And Mark rips his shirt off and muscles everywhere, you know, it's a nine pack, and he's like, and these ladies looked at me. Well, hello. So here's the crazy thing about this. I am being treated as if I had merit that I did not have. I am receiving the blessing of adoration and attention for something that was not mine because of a substitute, because of a stand-in. Don't you see? Don't you see? Don't you see? Eternal life, joy forever, resurrection is yours, not because you earned it, because the stand-in earned it. Whew, that's a nice mountain. That's a majestic peak. Listen, you need to remember this. Christian, you need to remember this. You need to be reminded of it over and over and over again. There's a little story about a pastor who lived in an apartment building, and in the basement of the apartment building was this Coke machine, and in the Coke machine would, like, sometimes they put the pennies in or the coins in, right? And it was, you'd had a Coke machine before, you put the coins in and nothing happens. So what do? The Coke machine. Well, you hit it, right? Hard on the side of it as much as you can, right? Jason, born that thing. You know you're given it. then finally the coins in this machine would drop if you hit it enough, and then you could get the Coke. Anyway, this pastor's wife, she came up after getting a Coke one time, and she said, you know what you're doing every week as a pastor? You put the coins of that gospel in there, and then they get stuck. And everyone looks at you like, meh, and you just take your hand, you just start hitting them on the side of the head, and then the next week you hit them some more on the side of the head. Don't you see? Don't you see? Don't you see? And you're praying and hoping that the pennies will drop. Oh, that the penny would drop. Of how beautiful this thing is. I'm on this word. I would remind you, we got 1, 2, 3, 4 in. This is good. It's going really well, okay? Second, the gospel must be held fast in order to achieve its goal. We need to be reminded of its magnificence, but it's something that we need to hold fast. Look at the language, okay? This is the beginning of the passage again. I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received. Notice what happens here. The gospel is something that you receive, right? It's not something that, you know, if you're going to get a gift, it's not yours until you receive it, right? So if you were going to give me a BMW, which I'm hoping might happen a little bit later, you're going to say, here are the keys, and I'm going to say, great, but it's not mine until I hold on to the key. It's mine now. I've taken possession of it. The gospel is something. It's a message, yes, but it's a message to be received, to be owned, to be stood in, right? In which you stand and by which you are being saved. If you hold fast to the word I preached to you. What is the word? It's the gospel message. If you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. See, because you can believe in vain. What does that look like? Well, it means starting out and then stopping. It means taking the keys and saying, I like this car. And then someone else coming along, give me those keys. And you're like, yeah, okay. And you say, yeah, okay, because it doesn't really matter to you anymore. It's not the thing that you care most about. And so you don't hold it fast. But the gospel, in order for it to have its effect, must be held fast. This is a repeated thing throughout the New Testament. Hebrews 3, but Christ is faithful over God's house as a son. And we are his house if indeed we what? Hold fast our confidence and our boasting and our hope. For we have come to share in Christ, if indeed we what? Hold fast our original confidence firm to the end. It's not about how you start. Listen, I know in the Christian circles, and we should celebrate baptism all the time. And now celebrate when somebody says, I prayed to receive Christ. That is awesome. Awesome. We should celebrate it in the same way we celebrate the beginning of a race. But you don't get the reward unless you finish the race. So yay, you began. But continue. Continue. So what does it look, what do we mean specifically when we say, well, what does it look like to not hold fast? It's interesting, the next little verse in Hebrews 3 says, as it is said, today, notice these quotes, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as they did in the rebellion. What is that? So the people of Israel had come to the edge of the promised land. God saved them out of Egypt, miraculously, graciously took them out of Egypt. They crossed the Red Sea. Pharaoh was buried into it. They come across the wilderness. God provides for them through manna, right? Bread in the wilderness and water in the wilderness. And so they get to the edge of the promised land and they say, okay, God's given this to us. They send in 12 spies. The guys come back. What's your report? And 10 of them are like, it's impossible. They're huge, these people. Like, what are we going to do? 2 of them are saying, God, come on, let's go take them. But the 10 win the day, and they tell all the people, no, no, we can't do this. What is that? That was the rebellion. That was the moment that what they did was they hardened their hearts. And so the writer of Hebrews says, look, don't you see? To not hold fast to the gospel is when a whole bunch of people who were saved, who have an experience of salvation, right, coming across the Red Sea, and even celebrate the things that churches celebrate by the Lord's Supper, right, the bread and the cup, which is the drink of Christ. They had all of these experiences. They come to the edge of the promised land, and they didn't finish what was begun. Christians can begin and not finish what was begun and prove by their not continuing that it's all for naught, that their belief was in vain. Salvation belongs to those who receive the gospel and continue in it. And what's interesting about this little passage here is that here's what they do. They get to the edge of the promised land. They hear the word of the Lord. Go forward, right? I'm going to promise you, I'm going to take it. So they hear the actual word of God, just like you and I get the word of God in the scriptures. And they say, nah, I don't think so. And then they persist in the I don't think so. They're willful in the I don't think so. And they're unrepentant in the I don't think so. They hold their hand against God and they do what we call a high-handed sin and say, I don't like your commands and I'm not doing them. Are you a Christian? Seriously, is this holding fast to the word that was preached? No. This is hardening your heart. I have another friend. We used to, last church I served, we used to ride our bikes to a place 30 miles away for a pastor's conference. There were a whole bunch of our pastors, and some of them would drive, but like five or six of us would always ride our bikes there. 30 miles, it's not hard. There was one guy, he was our youth pastor at the time, and he came along, and you know, youth pastors are just there. He was new to this whole thing. He'd never really ridden a bike, and so he showed up for our bike ride, 30-mile bike ride, and he had this like old Huffy bike that I think he'd picked up at a garage sale somewhere. It had a banana seat on it. He was sitting back, and he had somehow decked it out like a youth pastor would with like stereo equipment, like hanging off of it, speakers and a receiver. And he said, check it out. And he turned it up, and we're listening to Newsboys or whatever the heck it was while we're riding down the street. And all of us were saying, Sean, I don't think you understand. This is all going to go wrong. You're setting yourself up for failure because this bike's not going to make it. You're going to hate this music in a couple miles, right? He's like, no, this is going to be great. It's not a piece of cake, right? So he starts riding, and then he starts sweating, taking off his clothes because, you know, he had worn jeans because 30-mile bike ride. So he's like, oh, it's hot out here. He starts shoving stuff in his backpack. A few miles later, he's like, I hate this music, and he shuts it down. And I had made a deal with everybody that was always the same every year. If we ride and we get to the destination, then I will buy you all sandwiches at this amazing place in the back of a gas station. I know, but it's cool. So there's a reward in it. So anyway, we start going and stuff. But seriously, halfway through, he was on the side of the road lying face down. His speakers had been thrown to the wayside like a mile before. I will come back and get these. Right? Stereo equipment's everywhere. And he's like, I can't do anymore. I'm like, come on, man. You got to get up. No, it's too hard. It's hot. I said, just come back for me. Come back for me. You save yourselves. Right? Anyway, we got there. Somebody comes back. They pick him up and they come and take him to the place where we're eating sandwiches. He sits down across from me and he's like, I'm so hungry. And I'm like, so? And he said, what do you mean so? The deal was that you finish the ride and you get the sandwich. The deal was not you begin the ride and you get the sandwich when you quit. Listen very closely to me. Those who claim to be believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, who begin by faith but stop holding fast to the word of Christ, are not Christian people. Gospel is something to be reminded of. The gospel must be held fast to achieve its goal. The gospel, third, is a fact. So check this out. 1 Corinthians 15:3, I think. For I delivered to you as of first importance. You ever go to lunch with somebody and guys, I'm talking to you specifically here, you go to lunch with a friend, right, who your wife is friends with their wife. And so you go to lunch with your friend who's the guy and you're sitting across, you have a conversation, you come home and your wife says to you, what did you talk about? Now you have a decision to make right now. Here's your decision. You talked about a whole lot of stuff. You know you did. You talked about sports. You talked about whatever. There were some things that were mentioned like, hey, we're pregnant. That was in the middle of it, okay? In our male mind, we're like, yeah, that was like one of the things. Also, he's got Bears season tickets, right? What she wants you to do is to sift through all of that and figure out what is of first importance to communicate. What is the thing that is the most important to communicate with her? And you say, I don't know. And then a few days later, she says, she's pregnant. You know that. Oh, yeah, he did mention that. Ah, I can't believe you. She freaks out because you're supposed to share the key thing, the most important thing. This is Paul's basically saying, there's a lot of things that you can say about Jesus. There's a lot of things you can say about Christianity, but I delivered to you guys as of first importance. Like, this is the number one, you know, asterisk, bold, italicized thing. It was what I also received. What is of first importance, Paul? That Christ died for our sins. The message, the gospel message, that you are righteous in Jesus and he took on your sin for you. He did that in accordance with the scripture. Then he was buried and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. And note this, he appeared to Cephas, which means Peter, and he appeared to the 12, and then he appeared to more than how many? 500 brothers at one time. Here's Paul saying, okay, so here's the most important message that I delivered to you. It's this gospel message, and I know it sounds crazy that there's a guy who actually rose from the dead. He predicted he would raise from the dead. He said he was God and had authority over death, and then he did have authority over death, proving everything he said was true. I know that sounds crazy, but here's what you got to understand. I'm not telling you this like someone would tell you about an alien abduction. Dude, I was out in the field the other day, and I was standing there, and all of a sudden, aliens came down, and they sucked me up, and they probed me in with their pokers. And you're standing there going, really? Was there anybody else around? No, everyone ran away. It was just me up there. And you're like, yeah, it didn't happen. Why didn't it happen? Well, because he's just a story. And nobody can corroborate it, but the Apostle Paul's like, but see the people who can corroborate this? This event, this resurrection didn't happen in some like backwater. It's not like, you know, some guy went up into the mountains and God visited him and he came back with tablets and says, look, I have tablets from God. And you're like, I don't know, those look like you made them. I know they're from God. You have no corroborating witnesses, but the gospel of Jesus Christ, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, is presented as fact. You say, oh, come on. How could I possibly verify that? Okay, most of them are still alive. Over there on 4 Christian Boulevard is Johnny. You can ask him. He saw him. And Susie over there on Golgotha Way. And here's their address and phone number. You need their Snapchat. Like, he's giving everyone, look, you can go ask anybody about this. Which is so important because the resurrection of Jesus Christ is a fact that witnesses can verify. And you should follow Jesus then, not because it makes you feel good, even though it might, not because he gives you eternal life, even though you should. You should follow Jesus because not to is to live a lie. You should follow Jesus because it's true. And listen, that's a really important thing, because if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ for something other than the fact that it's true, because of a feeling, because he gives you good circumstances, that when those feelings fade and those circumstances change, your faith was rooted in these changing things and you will not hold fast. But if it's true, then it doesn't matter how you feel about it. He rose. And that changes everything. This has been a debate in the church for I don't know how many years. People have tried to come along and say, yeah, okay, fine. But the resurrection's not true. So there's a whole bunch of theories that people have come up with to try to explain these facts. These are the accepted facts, all right? Everyone agrees with these facts. Everyone in history, everybody around. You might get some nut job on the periphery, but they're shouted down by almost everybody in the history of history. These are the facts. Number one, Jesus lived and died. There's more evidence that Jesus lived and died than there is for Caesar. Jesus lived and he died. The tomb was empty. If the tomb wasn't empty and Jesus was there, then the Jewish leaders would have produced a body. Yes? And all of it would have just been taken care of. You guys are saying he's alive? Here he is, dead. We're going to string him up and show everybody. Couldn't do it because the tomb was empty. Third, Jesus' followers claimed to have seen him. I'm not saying they necessarily did or didn't, but they did make this claim. You just read it. And these followers who ran away at his arrest, all of a sudden, because they claimed that they saw him, became these ridiculously bold people who died without ever recanting that truth. History shows us that some of the apostles were thrown off the tops of buildings. Recant? No. They throw them off, they land, they're lying on the ground still alive, so they come down with stones. You want to recant now? No. And they kill them. When you're lying on the ground, this might be an opportunity for you to admit the lie, yes? They were hung upside down, crucified upside down. You want to recant? No, they were fed to wild beasts. You recant! What you saw isn't true. No, it's true. Kill me. So you have to come up with something that explains those four facts. So some people come up and say, all right, but here's the thing. So he wasn't really dead when he was on the cross. So these professional Roman soldiers whose only job was to figure out whether people were dead or alive, and their own lives were tied to the fate of the person on the cross. So if they got it wrong, they themselves would be killed. They made a mistake. They put him in a tomb. He was wrapped up in this shroud. They sealed it with this massive stone, and they put a Roman seal on it and put guards out in the front. But Jesus woke up in the middle of that thing. He was beaten and bloodied. You know, he'd been whipped and hands nailed to the cross, but he had the most energy to unwrap himself, right, and then wrap it back up so that when it was found, it was completely intact, this shroud. And so then he gets to the door, and he goes, and the soldiers are like, what's that? But you know, he does his abracadabra, right? And he rolls back this massive stone with his super Jesus power, and he comes out and he, Chuck Norris is everybody, right? And then he goes off to France, because why wouldn't you? Really? That's our explanation for this. Well, what about all the people who claim that they saw him and then they died for it? This doesn't make any sense. All right, fine. It was a lie then. They came and they stole the body of these disciples who had just run away. They get all this courage. They come and they just beat up the guards, steal Jesus' body, roll the stone back themselves. They come back out and then they die for what they knew was a lie. See, I know lots of people who might die for a belief, right? But they always believe the belief is true. Do you know anybody who on the edge of death told a lie about it? It's like, I'm totally going to die for this lie that I know is a lie. Wouldn't you think one of them would have recanted? But none of them recant. So that doesn't work. Okay, it's a legend. It's just a legend. It grew up over time, right? You know, fish was this big. Jesus was a really good dude. And then he's God and he rose from the dead. You know what's crazy? This little passage that we're looking at, it was an early Christian hymn. This is the way they would remember their theology. They'd write songs about it. And this is an early Christian hymn. Jesus died in 33 AD. Yes, 33. The book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, was written around 51. It takes about 10 years for a creed to develop and be known by all the churches around. And so what? Maybe they started this belief in 34. You got 10 years. That's 44. This was written within 7 years of when this creed was known about everyone. There were people who still were alive who had seen him. If it was a legend, don't you think somebody would have stood up and said, that's not what I remember? But you don't have that. So look, I'm just asking you to be logical. I'm actually asking you to play good history here. Be consistent with your history. The best explanation for what happened at the resurrection was that he was raised. It's a fact. And it's a fact that changed the world. So here's the last one, right? Notice what it did to the Apostle Paul, this message. He says, last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. I'm the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church. Paul was like, he was a murderer who was running around gathering up Christians who believed and throwing them into prison and trying to kill them. So when he gets confronted by God, drawn into the kingdom, you know, he's all flat on his back on a road to Damascus, and he gets dragged into the kingdom of God. He's now sitting at like lunch with the people days earlier he was trying to kill. You think he might be a little sheepish? I would.
Oh, I'm really sorry about that whole killing thing.
He would always live with the knowledge that he was the one who was trying to destroy the church. He was the one who was a murderer. He was the one. He has this past. You got a past? Paul's got a past. He couldn't believe that he of all people, would be welcomed into the kingdom of God. But by the grace of God, he said, by the grace of God, I am what I am. This is how it happened to me. And his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them. Don't you see what's happened here? The grace that he was shown, this massive grace, resulted in hard work. Because the greater your grace, the greater your understanding of how much you've been given by Jesus, how much you were owed, right? Nothing, and how much you were given everything, that gap right there is the thing that's gonna drive your worship. And if you have a little tiny gap, if you say, it's not that important. I was a really good person. Jesus sort of just helps me out a little bit. So you have a gap like this, your worship is this big. But if, like Paul, you've got this massive gap of what you deserved and what it is that Jesus gave you, then this is what drives your worship. What drives your worship? You know what I mean by worship. I don't mean just singing. I mean your response to God, your Christian life. You know, the solution to low-level, little-commitment, Christian living isn't more understanding of commands. It's not me yelling at you to do better. The solution is more understanding of grace. So let me just finish with this picture. Afterwards, you come up to me in the foyer and you say to me, here's the keys to your BMW. And then, thank you. And then you say, I also need you to know that I have kidney failure. And I'm like, that's awful. Yeah, I don't have long to live. Now, imagine I take one of two options for a response. The number one, I say to you, wow, that is horrible news. I feel awful. I feel like I want to do something to help you. So somebody gave my daughter these Peeps, which are these marshmallow hideous things that people eat around Easter, and I don't want them. Because yuck, I want to give them to you. And you're like, oh, thanks.
Don't mention it. You'll do me a favor one day, right? So. Or I say to you, wow, that's really hard. You got kidney failure. What's your blood type? And you tell me. I say, I think that's my blood type. We go to the doctor. The doctor checks me and says, you'd be a good kidney donor. And I say, cool, take that baby out. Give it to him. We go into surgery. You get the kidney. You're alive. We come out of surgery. We're sitting there in the beds next to each other, half drunk on our drugs. And I'm looking over to you and saying, how you doing? And you are saying what now? Thanks. Are you? Is it thanks for the peeps? Or are you effusive? Are you thinking to yourself, I don't have any idea how I could ever thank you and pay you back for such a magnanimous, remarkable gift? Don't you see that the greater the gift, the greater the response? If Jesus gave you not just a kidney, but life eternal when you deserved life in hell, what do you respond with? How are you responding? Look, if you're here and you're new to church or you're new to faith or maybe you're coming back to the church from a long time, I need to tell you this right now. The response that you need to make right now is Jesus is commanding you by the power of the Holy Spirit to repent and believe the gospel, to say, listen, I need that. I need salvation. I need forgiveness. Everything you said is true. I have a failure of my own doing. I need somebody who can make things right. My life needs to be made right. Dude, there is no coincidence that you're here right now on this Easter Sunday and that this nut job is standing up here dancing around and telling you these things. God brought you here. He wants you to hear this word so that you would repent and believe and rejoice forevermore in his presence. That you yourself could be called, seriously, as you walk out today, you came in as being under the wrath of God. You could walk out as a child of the living God. So, what do you got to do? You know what? Have mercy on me, a sinner. Lord, I need what you give. But most of the people in the room aren't in that situation. This is a story and a message you've probably heard lots and lots of times. This is the meh. It's the thing that you see all the time around town. Yes, yes, it's majestic. It's fantastic. It's great. But man, if it's going to have the effect that it needs to have, if it's something that you will hold fast, it needs to be so grand. This gap needs to be so grand that you will do anything to have it. And the only way to get there is to remind yourself of it over and over and over again, to pull over to the side of the road and open the door, even when nobody else is with you, and stand there and say, I cannot believe that somebody like me has been brought into his kingdom and sat at his table. And that in 10,000 years, I will still be sitting at his table, lavished on with grace upon grace in a heavenly bliss that far extends beyond anything you could dream or imagine. And I got it because of him. Man, if that rolls in your head and the penny starts to drop, you cannot imagine what the Lord will do with that. Feel the gap and see how it makes you worship. Lord, I'm thankful for my friends. I'm thankful for the opportunity to share the gospel with them. Remind us again and again of its majesty, we pray. And if there are those here who don't know you yet, Lord, honestly, I pray, Spirit, you'd come and you just grab their hearts right now, tug on them and say, no, I'm talking to you. And in response, Lord, I pray that they would beat their chest and say, yes, have mercy on me, Lord, a sinner. I want what you have to give. I will follow you the rest of my days on earth so that I might spend the rest of eternity with you in the joy of your Father. And we pray in Jesus' good name. Amen.
Let's stand to our feet as we wrap up our service today. Let the Lord seal to our hearts all that he's been teaching us.
The God who loves you. And maybe you're here today because that God who loves you wants you to return. You've been in rebellion. You've heard the truth. You might have even responded at one point. And you're like, man, that's why I'm here today. I'm going to respond to the truth that my life can be made righteous with him. Others are here today, and you're like, wow, I was brought by somebody, and that was powerful. And that gap, it's big. Me? That could be me? Yes. Anyone who hears and believes, who calls upon the name of the Lord, can be saved. You can repent. That can be your story today. There's going to be people up front here who would just love to have an opportunity to pray with you, love to have an opportunity to talk with you. There's things going on throughout your day, but this is the most important part of our day, to worship the Lord, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who made a promise that only he can deliver on. And that promise is that we can have life and we can have it eternal. And then those of us who know Jesus, we get to take that message and we get to be on mission. Whether it's at the dinner table today, in our neighborhood this week, in our work or in our community, Lord, help us. Help us to communicate it well. Help us to communicate it with love. And as you walk out of here today, happy Resurrection Day, know that you are loved.